Hi friends, as you might have talked to several toppers this year as well as last year, what we understand is the common point that most of the toppers say is daily answer writing practice. So daily you should write 2 to 3 questions and answers so that in the mains you can score very good marks, and the UPSC rank mostly depends upon your mains, both general studies as well as optional. So keeping this in mind, I am starting the daily answer writing practice for mains. Here what I do is, every day I give 2 questions and the next day I will provide the answers for those 2 questions. While explaining the answers, I would also discuss some of the tips or strategies that you can use to finish the answer quickly and more effectively. So today let us discuss the yesterday's question. This was the question that I gave yesterday. So what is a middle income trap? Do you think India will fall into the middle income trap? They're asking, do you think? So you can write your opinion. If you think, why do you think? If you don't think, why don't you think? Like that. Can India avoid it? So there are 3 questions. Generally in the UPSC general studies mains, they ask a combination of 2 to 3 questions together. There's a common trend. And when they give 15 marks for this question, it's like something like first question 5 marks, second question 5 marks, third question 5 marks, you know, like that. Okay, 250 words actually means those people whose handwriting consists of small letters, the small words, whose writing is smaller, they can finish the answer in 2 pages. Some people whose handwriting is bigger generally, they take up to 3 pages. So the answer generally falls under 2 to 3 pages. So let us see how to write this answer effectively to get more marks. First, as I told you, we always start with introduction, a very short introduction, 2 to 3 lines, then the body of answer, the main body of the answer, then the conclusion, again some 2 to 3 lines. And in this body of answer, you should address all 3 parts of the question. And if possible, not for all the questions, wherever possible, you can draw some flowcharts or diagrams, etc., to make it easier for examiner. Now, coming to the answer for this question. See, we should first start explaining in the introduction, we should explain what is a middle income trap. But instead of directly coming to what is a middle income trap, first you write 1 or 2 lines explaining what kind of income they're talking about here. What is the income that they mean here when they say middle income trap? So the income here is measured as a GNI, gross national income per capita. They're actually measuring the per capita income. If you see the World Bank divided all the countries in the world into low income countries, the middle income countries and the high income countries. You can in fact draw a diagram also like this, the low income, middle income, high income. Low income means the GNI per capita is less than $1,005 per year. The middle income countries are from $1,006 to $12,235. And more than $12,235 is high income. So just these 2 numbers you may have to remember. Generally, in the economy answers, if you can provide some numbers, statistics, it will be better. But if you don't remember, it's okay. You can just explain the concept without using any numbers. Because see, as I have gone through the answer before explaining, I might have remembered more numbers than you. But in the real scenario, when you write the answer, definitely you cannot use most numbers, like how we explained in this class. Anyhow, this is a very important statistic. You may remember this one. So the gross national per capita income is what they are measuring. And according to them, the middle income means a country in which the per capita income lies between $1,005 to $12,235 per year. Now let us write what is middle income trap. Now comes the definition of what the question actually asked for. Middle income trap means, for example, a country which was growing fast previously, whose GDP growth was really fast previously, which has got sustained GDP growth, suddenly the GDP growth is staggering. Suddenly it became stagnated in the middle income. So the growth which happened in the past is not happening now. That is called middle income trap. That means a country which you are expecting to actually reach the higher income, his GDP growth is actually staggered in the middle income itself. This is called middle income trap. So we explained the first part of the question. However, in UPSC mains generally, in the introduction part, it is better to write the context. If you can understand the context under which the question is given, write one or two lines about the context. For example, this middle income trap term has actually come in the economic survey 2018. So you can mention one or two lines about it. You can say that the economic survey 2018 mentioned the late convergence stall. The late convergence stall that India is facing, because of which there is a chance, you know, there is no guarantee, there is a chance of middle income trap. You can mention one line like this. Generally in the economy answers, if possible, you write the about the budget statement or economic survey or any other government report, Niti Aayog report, just mention it in the answer. It will fetch more marks. Now come to the second part of the question. They're asking you specifically, do you think India will fall under the middle income trap? So you can directly say that, yes, I think India may fall under the middle income trap. And you have to explain the reasons. Why are you thinking so? I think because of the following reasons. You mention some four or five reasons and then move on. For example, one reason I think is the GDP growth of India is falling consistently. For example, from 1991, after the economic reforms started in India, LPG reforms started in India, gradually the Indian economy has grown very fast. Almost in the last 28 to 30 years, our economy has grown 10 times of the 1991 level. In fact, in 1999 and in 2010 and in 2016, the GDP growth of India was above 8.5%, which is a very great number, above 8.5% for India. However, of late, in the last 2 to 3 years, the GDP growth has fallen down. For example, 2019, the GDP growth of India is just above 5%, just above 5%. So from this, I am telling you, means you write in the exam that from this data, I think that India may fall in the middle income trap because the GDP growth is falling consistently. Then the second reason, you have to see, any point, try to conclude in 2 to 3 lines. You should not take a point and explain it for 5 lines. In that way, if you write, you know, each point for 4 to 5 lines, you cannot finish the answer in 2 pages. Second point, you can say that another reason why India is under the India may fall in middle income trap. Another reason is our development model is not really, you know, good enough for a higher GDP growth in a long term. Why? Because India is an agricultural country. Now we became almost like a service sector country. That means in the Indian economy, service sector is contributing to almost 55-56% of GDP. The manufacturing sector is contributing just 17%, which is not a good, you know, way of development. For example, if you take countries like China or Asian tiger countries, the Eastern Asian economies, they have grown from agricultural countries to manufacturing countries, the industrial hubs, and only then they move to service sector. So that is the kind of development which is essential if you want to provide more jobs, because manufacturing sector has enough jobs, whereas service sector helps in GDP growth but does not provide good number of jobs. We call it as jobless growth. In India, we are seeing the jobless growth. So you will say that you know, almost 90% of Indian workers, labor, are working in the unorganized sector. Because of that, the per capita income cannot actually grow in the long term. The next point. Then you can mention, if you remember, you can mention some international reports as an evidence for your conclusion that India may fall under a middle income trap. You can mention some reports. For example, the World Bank gave India 115th rank in the Global Human Capital Formation Index. Human capital formation means, you know, the making the Indian citizens, Indians, strong in education, health and skill, so that they can contribute for the GDP growth, economic development of India. In that, the world, India's rank is 115, which means we are actually not really emphasizing on the education, health, skill development. Without that, how can we expect to grow fast in the long term? That's another point you can mention. Similarly, the Asian Development Bank in its report mentioned that India is having a lopsided expansion. Lopsided expansion means in India, only few sections of society is getting all the benefits. For example, top 10% of Indians are getting the actual benefit of the economic growth. That means the income distribution is not equal. Income inequality is there. As long as income inequality is too high, it is difficult for India to reach the high income growth. You can mention that. And one more thing is, you know, as I told you, in India, if you take Indian economy as a pyramid, the top 10% of the pyramid, they are creating the demand for economy. Their purchases is creating demand for economy. So now recently what happened, the demand of this top of the pyramid sections has fallen down. You can quote an example like a fall in the auto sales, a fall in the automobile consumption, that means purchasing automobiles, which is done by the top 10% generally, it has fallen down, which is an indication, it's evidence that the demand in India is falling down. So there is a chance of middle income trap. You understand that? Similarly, you can say that, you know, during the early convergence, the globalization was good enough. Actually, only when the globalization is good enough, India can export goods, it can import services or goods, whatever. As the trade grows, Indian economy will develop, it will expand. That's why in the earlier years, the Indian economy has grown very fast. But of late, in the last few years, there is increasing protectionism, because of which the trade is falling down, because of which the GDP growth has fallen down. See, you can even mention example that the China, the Japan, other East Asian tiger economies, when they are actually called early convergers, because they have grown previously when hyper-globalization was there. Hyper-globalization means globalization is in a good pace. Trade is happening very well throughout the world. There is no protectionism in those days. At that time, those economies have grown. But India is a late converger. So presently, India is facing the problem of protectionism throughout the world. That point you can mention. Then, one more important thing is, for economy to grow, the businesses require enough capital. For that, the banks have to lend enough. But that lending in India has decreased. Why? Because banks are facing the problem of non-performing assets. Because of that, the Indian economy may not grow as good as it was previously growing. Okay, so this is the answer for the second part of the question. Second part of the question means, do you think India is falling in middle income trap? I think yes, I think so, because of these reasons. These are the various reasons. Now let's come to the third part of the question. The third part is, can we avoid the middle income trap for India? Definitely, you have to always say yes only. For this, you cannot say no, because you should sound optimistic in your answers as much as possible. So yes, we can avoid the middle income trap for India by following the below things. Okay. Naturally, as you write the answer very fast in UPSC mains, you first identify some problems. For example, the previous slide I have shown you the problems, right? Next slide, they are just the solution for the previous problems, that's all. Each point is a solution for the previous problem. For example, see, I told that human capital formation is a problem for India. So you have to focus on the human capital formation. You have to invest in the education, invest in the health infrastructure, invest in the skill development. While writing this point, you can mention one or two government schemes also. Skill development of India, you can mention two or three schemes that you know. Or regarding the health, you can mention two or three schemes. Generally, in the UPSC answers, as we mention government schemes, acts and policies, there is more chance of getting better marks. Similarly, you know, one of the solutions is, India should be based on knowledge economy. Our economy should not be just based on the resources, because resources may exhaust at some point of time. But if our economy is based on the knowledge of people, the knowledge-based economy, in the long term, the knowledge will not exhaust. It will only grow. So economy will also grow. Similarly, we have to encourage innovation, because in future, only the innovators can actually grow fast economically. So you can mention about the Atal Innovation Mission, National Science and Technology Mission. You can mention all these things. Then, you know, as I told you in the earlier slide, one of the problems is manufacturing sector is contributing only 17%, which is bad. That's why we have to say we have to incentivize the industries, the manufacturing sector, because it is these industries that actually provide large scale employment. Only when employment increases, we can provide, you know, the per capita income of the country will increase. That's the only way. Okay, you can write about Vision 2025 or Niti Aayog report of how you want to increase manufacturing. You can just mention one line. Then, as I told you in the previous slide, that the non-performing assets is a problem for the banks, due to which they are unable to lend. So what we have to do? We have to increase the lending capacity, not only of the banks, but also non-banking finance companies. Because economy cannot just be dependent on the banks. Even the non-banking finance companies shall help in the lending. So in that, you have to solve the problems of NPAs. Of course, Reserve Bank of India and the Finance Minister of India are following several methods to solve NPAs. You can mention one or two of them. Then you can say infrastructure. For the long-term growth, for the future GDP growth to increase in India, we have to invest more in the infrastructure. It can be ports, airports, naval ports. It can be, transmission lines, the power plants, roads, highways, whatever, etc., the railways. In fact, you can mention that recently UAE, is investing almost $75 billion in the Indian infrastructure, because India is attracting the investment in infrastructure throughout the world. It's the only way, only by this kind of capital expenditure, we can cross the middle income trap, we can go to the higher income. Okay, then finally, you can write, land reforms are required, labor reforms are required, you can write what other reforms you want, without, no need to explain them, just write, these are the reforms required for, not falling in the middle income trap. Like that, you have to mention the point in two, three lines, that's all. Because it's the scope of UPSC means, you cannot go beyond that. Finally, conclude with just three or four lines, conclusion. For example, in the conclusion, you can say that there is no actual data to prove that middle income trap is coming for India. There's no data. Just we are thinking that there's a chance, that's all. And also, you can mention that generally, it is better you assume the worst. Better you assume the worst. Assume that middle income trap may happen for India and try to prevent it from now. You can say prevention is better than cure. Something, some quote, if possible, or some optimistic way of telling that we can solve the problem. In this way, you can conclude the answer. And this answer should be written in almost 11 minutes. You may be knowing that in UPSC, for 10 marks question, 15 marks question. 10 marks question, around 7 minutes you have to take. 15 marks question, around 11 minutes. Only then you can finish all 20 questions, in 3 hours generally. So, the questions for tomorrow. You can just pause the video at this stage. You can note the question. This is the first question for tomorrow. It is regarding the plastic pollution, the plastic waste in the oceans. Then the next question, you can pause here again, make a note of the question. Generally, I'm trying to give the questions which I think are important for 2020 UPSC mains. You make note of these questions. Write the answer for these questions today. Tomorrow morning, you can see my explanation for these questions. Like that, every day we'll be practicing two questions. But remember, try to finish them, finish both the questions. This is also 15 marks question. Try to finish them in almost 20 to 30 minutes time. In the initial days, you can take some 40 minutes, but gradually come down to 30 minutes, less than 20 minutes for answering both the questions. Okay. Thank you, friends. Bye.